Hi everyone, welcome to Guided Listening. Today's piece is Antar by Rimsky-Korsakov. It is true that Tchaikovsky is the most popular Russian composer and Stravinsky is perhaps the greatest, but no one influenced Russian music as much as Rimsky-Korsakov, and Antar is his second symphony, one of his earliest masterworks. Part 1, Background. During the long 19th century, from 1789 to 1914, European societies started to redefine themselves based on a new and modern concept of nationality. Part of this process involved a creation of a national style of art, especially music. It was during this time that Debussy created a French style of music. Smetana wrote his Mavlast, which is based on Bohemian legends. Nielsen and Sibelius introduced Scandinavian sounds into music, and many other composers increasingly turned to folk tunes as a source of inspiration. Mikhail Glinka's operas, the first truly Russian works, led to a wave of young Russian musicians who wanted to create a distinctively national school. In 1859, Nikolai and Anton Rubinstein created Russia's first music academy, but this wasn't the most important event. The most important one was the creation of a group called the Mighty Handful. The head of the group was Mili Balakirev, who wanted to get rid of Western influences in music. He thought that musicians didn't need to be trained in Western music theory. Kui, Borodin, Mussorgsky, and Rimsky-Korsakov followed his lead, and they started composing without having any formal training in music. Their music was a reaction against German music. In their meetings, they criticized the music of people like Mozart and Mendelssohn for their thematic plays or complicated counterpoints, and they glorified people like Schumann and Berlioz, composers with a strong poetic sense and a taste for programmatic content. Their music didn't rely on developing material, what Haydn called thematische Arbeit, which was a German approach. Instead, following Glinka, they preferred to repeat ideas with different instrumentations, and they borrowed from folk tunes a lot. As an example, let's listen to a theme from Balakirev's first symphony. Now let's listen to another theme, again a folk song. Now let's listen to a third example, which is again a folk tune. Other composers use these material too. For example, let's listen to a theme from the finale of Tchaikovsky's Fourth. Rimsky-Korsakov started composition as a member of Balakirev's circle, and Antar was one of the results of this period, which was composed in 1868. But Rimsky-Korsakov never felt satisfied. He wanted a systematic knowledge of music theory. That's why in 1871 he accepted a teaching position at the Conservatory of St. Petersburg and learned music theory while having to teach it to his students. The other members of the Mighty Handful were furious. But now Rimsky-Korsakov showed them his own mighty finger. This was a great event in the history of Russian music. With the help of Mitrofan Belyayev, Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov started helping young Russian musicians. A new school was formed around them, which shared the nationalist concerns of the mighty handful, but also had a deep knowledge of music theory. Rimsky-Korsakov became the teacher of Russia's next generation of musicians, people like Igor Stravinsky, Sergei Prokofiev, and Alexander Glazunov. After learning harmony and counterpoint, he started revising his earlier works, including Antar, which was revised twice in 1875 and 1897. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. During the 1860s, Hector Berlioz traveled to Russia and conducted some of his works, including Symphonie Fantastique. This was a multi-movement programmatic work in which Berlioz followed the thoughts and dreams of a young man himself who was in love with a girl that didn't notice him. He used a fixed musical idea, an idée fixe, to represent the girl and repeated it throughout the work. He also used different combinations of instruments to convey moods and feelings. Russian composers loved this idea, and a number of similar works followed. Balakirev's In Bohemia, Tchaikovsky's Romeo and Juliet, and of course Rimsky-Korsakov's Antar. Now, the story of Antar is based on an Arabic tale about a warrior called Antar ibn Shaddad. Antar was a slave who won his freedom by showing bravery in battle, and that's why he became the subject of a lot of legends and tales. One of Arabia's longest epics is about him, and this is exactly the text that Rimsky-Korsakov did not use. Yeah, he didn't use that. Instead, he used a story by Osip Senkovsky, who was a Russian writer. I know what you're thinking. Why would he use that Russian story when he could have used the actual Arabic epic? Now, we have to give him some credit. Our modern scientific approach to ethnomusicology was born in the 20th century. Exoticism, or the use of non-Western material in Western music, during the 19th century was a completely different approach. To make this clear, let's compare the methods of two different composers who used non-Western material in their compositions. The first one is Béla Bartók, a 20th century composer who had a great influence on ethnomusicology. Step 1. Go to all the villages and cities that you can, talk to people, and collect a massive number of folk songs that people sing. Step 2. Create a new system of notation which will allow the representation of pitch content which cannot be represented in traditional notation. And step 3, do an extensive study for years to find common characteristics. Now let's compare it to Dvorak's method, a 19th century composer who's famous for his American Symphony and American Quartet. Step 1, absorb the essence of modern America by looking at a few Native American folk songs. So Rimsky-Korsakov's approach too is conditioned by the shortcomings of the 19th century. His Arabs are European representations of Arabs, and his Arabic melodies are not a result of an extensive study of Arabian music. They're mostly attempts to imitate the sounds he heard in the music of Arabian gypsies in Russia. Part 2, what to listen for. Antar is a programmatic work, and one of the ways that musicians convey a program is by using fixed musical ideas which are tied to an external musical representation. For example, the idée fixe in Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique, which represents his beloved. Let's listen. Or the love theme in Tchaikovsky's Romeo and Juliet. Rimsky-Korsakov does the same here. The story is about the warrior Antar who's been betrayed by humans. He's wandering the desert until he sees a beautiful gazelle. Mesmerized by its beauty, his natural reaction is, I'm gonna eat that thing. So it starts chasing the gazelle, but suddenly he realizes that a bird is also chasing it. So now he feels sorry and instead attacks the bird. Later, in a dream, he realizes that the gazelle was actually a peri called Golnazar. She says that she's gonna make three of his wishes come true, but the only problem is that all of them are gonna end in pain and disappointment. Just like any other human who's facing a life-changing decision, Antar says, "The future. I want revenge, power, and love." Let's listen to the introduction. This passage is really important, first of all because it's built on something which is called an augmented scale. Scales are collections of notes which are organized in order. Now the most famous scales are the major and the minor. Let's listen to a major scale first and then a minor one. Let's listen to an augmented scale and compare. This is important for two reasons. First, because the augmented scale gives an exotic sound to the music. But second, and most importantly, this same scale was used by Franz Liszt in his False Symphony of 1857. Importance might not be obvious at first, but when you add this to the fact that Rimsky-Korsakov's harmonic plans are built on third relationships, something else that Liszt and other German romantics were doing, you realize that he's not just writing nationalist music, he's also closely following the most modern trends in the music of his time. Now let's get to the ideas which represent characters. First, we have the Antar theme. Let's listen. Here, Rimsky-Korsakov is mixing a minor collection with a Dorian collection, and again the result is an exotic sound. Now let's listen to the Golnazar theme. Here, the Arabic nature is obvious, which is because of the augmented second, an interval which is more commonly used in Middle Eastern music. In the second movement, we have the realization of revenge and its end in disappointment. Pay attention to the angry nature of the theme, which of course represents revenge. We'll be right back. Even Antar's original theme changes and becomes more like a military march. In the third movement, we see the idea of power. Pay attention to the triumphal march. Finally, in the last movement, we're presented with the idea of love, which also doesn't succeed in bringing happiness. In the end, we hear the Antar theme die away, which is a representation of his actual death near the end of the story. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe for weekly listening guides. Also, check out my music history videos. I hope you enjoy.